This is Mark Commode, a British film critic and musician who works with the BBC. He co-presents a BBC Radio 5 live show called Commode and Mayo's Film Review and has a documentary series on BBC 4 called Mark Commode's Secrets of Cinema. In his documentary series, he goes over different film genres and outlines the key conventions of what makes these genres so compelling. For our short film project, we will be creating a coming-of-age short, and so, as part of our research, we watched an episode of Mark Commode's Secrets of Cinema. In this, he outlined what makes a good coming-of-age film and the 9 key conventions of coming-of-age films. Generally, any age can watch and enjoy a coming-of-age film. Many children's animations such as Spirited Away, How to Train Your Dragon, and more recently, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse are considered great coming-of-age films. However, the main audience of coming-of-age films are concentrated around the age brackets of teenagers and even adults. Coming-of-age films typically follow a protagonist or a group of protagonists who are either in their pre-teens, coming into their teenage years, or in their late teenage years attempting to navigate the minefield of adulthood. Coming-of-age films are typically all about a big relatable change that the protagonist have to navigate and eventually come to terms with. This change can be anything from puberty to a house move. In Disney and Pixar's 2015 film Inside Out, Riley navigates both of these changes simultaneously, losing control of her emotions and her sense of self. Coming-of-age films tend to take place in familiar and relatable settings, such as a school hallway or a family dinner table. However, they also bring elements of unfamiliarity through settings like forests and fields to show either the character's freedom or them feeling out of their depth. Most of these stories come from real life, perhaps the writer or director's past, inspired by their own teenage years. A great example being Blinded by the Light, a 2019 film by Gurinder Chadha, inspired by the teenage years of Safraz Manjoo. The idea of teenagers and the concept of coming of age first came about in the 1950s, with Rebel Without a Cause coming out in 1955, being one of the very first coming of age films to come to our screens. Since these films come from our past, it makes sense that a huge majority of coming-of-age films are set in the past, happening in the 70s, 80s or early 2000s. However, as time moves on, there are more and more coming-of-age films coming out set in the now. Well, different people watch them for different reasons. Teenagers are invested in these types of films because they resonate with them. Coming-of-age films reflect what they are currently going through and gives them the sense that someone understands. For adults, coming-of-age films provide a sense of nostalgia, throwing them back into a time when these minuscule problems seem so much bigger, as well as to a time of firsts, first loves and first adventures. One of the biggest running themes in all coming-of-age films is finding yourself. This theme leaks through all coming-of-age films, even if the central idea is based on something else entirely. It is the basis and essence of any coming-of-age film. The very concept of a coming-of-age film is that the protagonist navigates a new and unfamiliar world, finding their true self during this is an inevitable byproduct. Mark Commode references the films Rebel Without a Cause, Breakfast Club and Moonlight when talking about this convention, but there are many, many other films that apply to this convention, such as Lady Bird or The Perks of Being a Wallflower. In many coming-of-age films, the writers will use a father figure to help facilitate the protagonist's search of self. This can be in a literal sense, like in Boy, or in a figurative sense, like with a prominent male figure, like Charlie's English teacher in The Perks of Being a Wallflower. There are a lot of visual motifs in these films that show the reader the protagonist's internalised conflict without having to put it into dialogue. In this search of self or journey of self-discovery, many protagonists are often seen actually travelling, whether this be running, cycling or driving. The way they travel tells us a lot about their internal conflict. Running, cycling and driving all suggest they want to escape. They are trying to break out of their current situation by literally running away from it. In comparison, more static or slow-moving modes of travel, like the floating on the Lilo in The Graduate, suggests an emptiness and a lack of motivation. Furthermore, interruptions in these breakouts of movement can foreshadow where the conflict lies early on in the film. In this clip from Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, we see Miles, the protagonist, running to school and trip when jumping. He then gets driven by his dad, who is a cop and is in a police car, to his new school. The moment when Miles trips when jumping because his laces were undone foreshadows Miles' future struggles with controlling his Spidey abilities. It could also foreshadow a moment later in the film where, due to his untied laces, he trips and breaks an important item, the goober. This scene also introduces the conflict between Miles and his dad.
Seriously, Dad, walking would have been fine.
You can walk plenty on Saturday when you peel those stickers off.
You saw that? I don't know if that was me, Dad.
And the two from yesterday on Clinton.
Yeah, those are me.
Mark Kermode specifies three settings that make the unfamiliar familiar for the audience and protagonist. A high school hallway, a small town road, and a family dinner table. He also mentioned that these films are often set in the past to evoke strong feelings of nostalgia or anomoya. Back to the Future is a great sci-fi twist to the typical coming-of-age film. The film follows the story of the teenager Marty McFly and his mad scientist friend Doc Brown. The pair run into problems after Doc creates a time machine out of a DeLorean. In Back to the Future, there is often a school environment. Much of the scenes in the school in the 1950s occurs in the hallway. This allows for the director to include extra information behind the scenes that emphasizes the time of 1955 in the audience's mind. For example, the fashion of extras and the design of the lockers are subtle aspects that help to send the audience back in time. The roads in Back to the Future, with their small shops cluttered with shop signs, help to make the story feel quite closed in and make the audience more focused on Marty and his development. Furthermore, it creates a warm, homey feel to the town, despite many of the audience never having been there. The one setting you can rely on in all three Back to the Future films is the family dinner table. This simple setting is where we can see the characters at their most natural and really understand the dynamics between characters. Back to the Future features time travel, with Marty travelling back to 1955, and at the time of its release in 1985, it would have been very nostalgia-evoking for many adults. The main ways the film achieved this was through its set, fashion, and also the cars used. Mark Kermode mentions the importance of casting, saying that because most of the actors you could cast for these roles would be younger and therefore inexperienced, it is vital to spend time on your casting decisions. Younger actors for coming-of-age films focused on preteens may not have even gone through these experiences of finding oneself just yet. This is why it is so important to find actors who are open to new experiences and are capable of being vulnerable on camera. Kermode states that if you have a character with behavioural issues, you should cast someone with similar attitudes. And if you have a character from a specific background, go to the similar places that those characters might go to and find your actors there. For the film Boy, Taika Waititi took a lot of care in his casting decisions. In this interview, he talks about why he cast James Rolston as the main character in Boy. You can see that Taika Waititi followed the same idea to Kermode when casting in Boy. He physically went to schools in New Zealand, asking the kids to audition for roles. This worked very well for casting the character of Boy, played by James Rolston, because Rolston had never actually been in a film, and this perfectly captured the character's innocent naivety.
Kia ora, my name is Boy, and welcome to my interesting world. My favourite person is Michael Jackson. Wanna see some Michael Jackson dance moves?
It was just a normal day at school, and a lady came in and asked us if we wanted to audition for a feature film. Yeah, and a couple of our students put up our hand, and yeah, went on from there. I met Taika at the audition, and I was casted as an extra. And then 3 days before shooting, I was casted as Boy. The reason why I auditioned was because I just wanted to try it out. I just wanted to, just experience what it's like.
I just wanted someone who had a kind of strong imagination and a nice innocence, you know, like someone who was like quite open to the world and open to everything around him, and someone who wasn't like too cool, you know, like that's the character really is, you know, the sort of hard done by kid who has trouble at school, you know, he's trying to find his way in the world and he gets picked on and stuff, and while that might not be James's reality, he's open enough and is a good enough actor to be able to, you know, to be that vulnerable.
You want your film to be authentic, particularly because coming-of-age films are so emotional, it can be very easy to tell if your cast don't understand the vision. The Perks of Being a Wallflower is a very melancholic, hard-hitting coming-of-age film following the character of Charlie as he goes through his first year as a freshman in high school. The story talks about some difficult topics like depression, anxiety, suicide and trauma, all from the perspective of a socially awkward 15-year-old Charlie. So, for a film that covers these topics so gracefully, you want an actor who will do it justice. Stephen Chbosky wrote both the book the film is based off of and also screenwrote and directed the film. He was well acquainted with the character of Charlie by this point and so worked closely with his casting director when the time came to cast Charlie. Logan Lerman was cast as Charlie and he portrays the character brilliantly, using subtle intonations in his speech and body language to get across Charlie's struggles with anxiety and trauma. One reason Lerman was well suited to the role was that he has a similar air of quiet humility as Charlie. Commode says that the use of pop music in coming-of-age films creates a sense of relatability for the audience, as these songs are so well known and are instantly recognisable. The use of pop music from the era of your film is set creates a huge sense of nostalgia for the audience, often even more so than the production design might. This is due to the strong connections we make between music and our memories. For example, a pop music from the 80s could evoke memories of a first kiss for an adult. We most often hear music diegetically in coming-of-age films. This is because we are constantly being immersed into the protagonist's life, experiencing what they experience, and therefore hearing what they hear. Some of the most iconic and memorable coming-of-age scenes are when diegetic music is played from the speakers of a school dance or a car radio, when the entire group gets up, dances and lets loose, or an intimate moment is shared between two characters through music. These are, in my opinion, some of the most cinematic scenes, but also the most relatable. We may not have ever been to a school dance or shared that intimate first kiss, but for as long as the music plays, we have.
I feel infinite.
music is used to its full potential in film, it has an incredible power to connect. In American Graffiti, Wolfman Jack's radio show is constantly played and referred to by the characters. It not only connects the characters in the town to one another, but it also connects the audience to the time of 1962, covering up any slight inaccuracies in production design and transporting the audience to that era. Throughout this entire scene, you can hear the show in the background, coming from the car radio. While not being very relevant to the exact scene, it is there as a constant reminder of the time.
Come on, boy, let's go. Prove it.
Why don't you go out and try to win yourself a few races? Man, you come on back and I'll show you a few things.
Oh, racing, you can beat him.
Hey, that's a tough-looking girl you got with you, man. What are you doing, trying to pick up a few extra buck babysit? Hey, dog, why don't you come on ride with me in about 10 years?
Now, leave her out of this. It's just between you and me.
Another example of this is in Moonlight, when two characters reconnect over a song. The song is so perfect for this scene because the lyrics speak all of the words these two characters are thinking without either of them saying a word. It is an incredible intimate scene and the song brings these two characters together.
Chuba, chuba, my baby. Chuba, chuba.
Hello, stranger. It seems so good to see you back again. How long has it been?
It seems like a mighty long time. Chuba, chuba, my baby.
Grown-ups tend to serve two purposes to the arcs of our protagonists: to inspire and understand them, or to disrupt their lives and create problems. In How to Train Your Dragon, this relationship with parents is explored in a more complex way over the trilogy. In the first film, Hiccup's father, Stoic, is distant from his son and overall disappointed with Hiccup's scrawny build and inability to fight and slay dragons. Stoic causes a huge disruption to Hiccup's life right when Hiccup is just beginning to understand the world by taking his newfound dragon friend, Toothless, away to be locked up. However, as the films progress, Stoic moves into this more understanding role and Hiccup and Stoic build a loving relationship, which is abruptly torn apart by Stoic's death.
I screwed up. I should have told you before now. You take this out on me. Be mad at me, but please, just don't hurt Toothless.
The dragon? That's what you're worried about? Not the people you almost killed?
He was just protecting me. He's not dangerous.
They've killed hundreds of us.
And we've killed thousands of them. They defend themselves, that's all.
Stop! Snap out of it! Toothless, no! Toothless!
Don't!
Pick up! Son!
Dad! No!
Dad!
No. No. from him! Go on, get out of here! Get away!
It's not his fault. You know that.
We often think of teenagers or preteens as the stars of coming-of-age films, but the adults can also be just as fleshed out as the protagonists. The film Boyhood is filmed over a 12-year period and follows the story of the protagonist Mason. However, over these 12 years we also see the story of his parents and the way that they develop and overcome their own problems. There is a heartwarming moment where Mason's mom comes to the realization that she feels like she's wasted her life raising kids and that there's no point to anything.
Did you put this in here again? I don't want it.
And it's the first picture you ever took.
Well, I mean, all the more reason to leave it behind, right? What?
Nothing.
No, what is it?
It's nothing.
Mom.
This is the worst day of my life.
What are you talking about?
I knew this day was coming. I didn't know you were gonna be so fucking happy to be leaving.
I mean, it's not that I'm that happy. What do you expect?
You know what I'm realizing? My life is just gonna go like that. This series of milestones. Getting married, having kids, getting divorced. The time that we thought you were dyslexic when I taught you how to ride a bike. Getting divorced again, getting my master's degree, finally getting the job I wanted, sending Samantha off to college, sending you off to college. You know what's next? Huh? It's my fucking funeral! Just go and leave my picture!
Aren't you jumping ahead by like 40 years or something?
I just thought there would be more.
Parents are obviously a huge part of the lives of our protagonist, but other adult figures can be just as important. For example, Charlie's English teacher Bill, in The Perks of Being a Wallflower, encourages Charlie to write more and is one of the few adults to make Charlie feel special and give him confidence. They become close outside of class and Bill becomes a trusted confidant, giving Charlie an important lesson that people accept the love they think they deserve.
Wow, that was fast. You want another one?
Yeah.
All right.
Mr. Anderson, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
Why do nice people choose the wrong people to date?
Are we talking about anyone specific?
Well, we accept the love we think we deserve.
Can we make them know that they deserve more?
We can try.
However, these outside adult figures can also be very destructive to the children. One of the most iconic examples of this being Miss Trunchbull from the film Matilda, who is the aggressive and borderline abusive principal at the new school Matilda is attending.
Like yesterday, in the second grade, the Trunchbull makes a weekly visit to every classroom to show the teachers a thing or two about handling kids. And Julius Rotwinkle ate 2 M&Ms during her lesson.
And she caught him?
Of course!
Was Julius okay?
After being thrown out the window? Of course he wasn't okay. He lived, if that's what you mean.
The gang is one of the biggest tropes in coming-of-age films. These gangs are often a group of people that have taken in our protagonist, for good or for worse. These gangs might have a strong set of values and be very close, like in the How to Train Your Dragon trilogy, Hiccup and his friends vow to protect Burke and to protect all dragons. The gang portrayed may also have a looser sense of togetherness, simply being people thrown together by circumstances out of their reach, like in But I'm a Cheerleader. These gangs can be dangerous for the protagonists because of their ritualistic behaviours, which can be addictive and can involve them in illegal activities. A great gore-filled example of this is in the film Raw, which follows a vegetarian student as she goes to veterinary college and becomes initiated into it by being covered in pig's blood and forced into eating a rabbit's kidney. From there, she becomes more and more involved in sex, drugs, and violence. Commode specifically mentions these gangs as ritualistic because, well, they are. Pitch Perfect is a great example of this with the initiation night. They have a ritual that allows them into the group, they have an agreement that they have to fulfill, and they have a specific rule that if broken is threatened with violent consequences.
Now if you'll place your scarves in your right hand. I sing your name.
I
promise to fulfill the duties and responsibilities of a Bella woman.
Promise to fulfill the duties and responsibilities of a Bella woman.
And I solemnly promise to never have sexual relations with a troublemaker, or may my vocal cords be ripped out by wolves.
And I solemnly promise to never have sexual relations with a troublemaker, or may my vocal cords be ripped out by wolves.
You are all Bellas now.
Awkward Young Love, the most overused and the most nostalgia-evoking trope of the coming-of-age genre. Submarine follows Oliver Tate as he sets out to get two things done before he turns 16, the first being losing his virginity. He starts by attempting to seduce his also unpopular classmate, Jordana. They share a very awkward, out-of-place relationship spanning over a very short period. Even though the relationship was so short-lived, Oliver describes feeling very strongly for Jordana, writing her a letter after they break up, asking her to take him back.
Jordana Bevan's moderately unpopular, which makes a romance between the two of us more likely.
Meet me under the bridge after school and we'll take you from there.
Now kneel down. Close your eyes. Wow, you look mentally retarded.
What are you going to do with the photos?
What are you complaining about? Is this conclusive proof they might not be gay?
I asked if she was my girlfriend now. She said,
I'll think about it.
But what she meant was, yes, we are now as one.
And my parents are going to the cinema on Thursday. The house is empty on Thursday evening.
Are you asking me to come round and have sex with you?
If I say yes, is that less than the chance of you wanting to?
To us, and a wonderful evening of lovemaking.
You're a serial killer.
With a new age comes new directors and screenwriters, one who used the young love narrative for good. My favourite example of this is But I'm a Cheerleader, which talks about an awkward and emotional relationship that blossoms after two girls, the protagonists Megan and Graham, end up sent to a conversion camp because their parents are, well, homophobic. Megan and Graham's relationship is very on and off, hot and cold, mainly because of this fight between accepting yourself and doing what others want you to do.
I work for a place called True Directions who help people like yourself learn to understand their homosexual tendencies.
What tendencies?
Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Why don't you start by telling us the first time that you realized that you might be a lesbian?
I'm not perverted. I get good grades. I go to church. I'm a cheerleader.
It's a long path to righteousness, Megan. And it's a battlefield of temptation out there, and you're gonna have to fight.
I'm not supposed to like you, but...
Ultimately, what coming-of-age films want you to remember is that you will never forget your first love. A Loss of Innocence is a pivotal turning point for the protagonists in their development. This loss of innocence can be something harsh, like Justine's loss of innocence in Raw, where she dabbles in sex and cannibalism. Or it can be something much more light-hearted, like in Toy Story 3, when Andy has to accept that he has grown up and gives the toys that were once some of his best friends away. A loss of innocence in characters can also come from when they realise people they once idolised are actually terrible people. This happens in The Perks of Being a Wallflower, when Charlie realises his Aunt Helen, who he once idolised saying she was his favourite person in the world, sexually abused him when he was young.
Secret, okay?
Look, Charlie, she's fast asleep.
Don't wake your sister.
My fault. It's all my fault.
It'll be our little secret, okay?
Stop it.
This loss of innocence also comes from the ending of school, like in Dazed and Confused, or the start of college, like in Toy Story 3, where the protagonist is forced to mature.
Now, you gotta promise to take good care of these guys. They mean a lot to me.
My cowboy!
What's he doing in there?
You're the snake in my boot.
What?
There's a snake in my boot.
Now, Woody, he's been my pal for as long as I can remember.
Many coming-of-age films end with the idea that this is actually where life begins for the protagonist. They've gotten through the hard bit now, they've struggled and come out of the other end of the tunnel. This same concept is used time and time again in coming-of-age films because it is comforting. We don't know exactly what happens to these characters after the film ends, but we still get some closure knowing that they've grown. But I'm a Cheerleader ends with Megan going back to save Graham and they drive off into the distance.
Graham. One, two, three, four. I won't take no anymore. Five, six, seven, eight. I want you to be my mate. One, two, three, four. You're the one that I adore. Five, six, seven, eight. Don't run from me, 'cause this is fate.
Breathe into my hands, I'll cut them like a glass to drink from.
I love you.
Megan! You stop it this instant, because you will wallow in the swamp of your homosexual depression the rest of your life.
Ends with the discovery that the cannibalism ran through the family, with the dad showing the scars from his wife, eating him.
Et puis un jour on a eu notre premier baiser. Et puis là j'ai compris. Mais je suis sûr que toi, tu trouveras une solution, ma puce.
Coming-of-age films also tend to end with some narration from the protagonist or someone close to the protagonist to give a solid sense of closure and wrap things up. In Inside Out, Joy, Riley's happiness emotion, concludes by telling us Riley's life is back on track. She's back on good terms with her family and she has made new friends.
Let's play some hockey!
We've been through a lot lately, that's for sure. But we still love our girl. She has great new friends, a great new house. Things couldn't be better. After all, Riley's 12 now. What could happen?
A more stark version of this is in Stand By Me, which ends with the protagonist Gordy in the present writing the end of his memoir, revealing that Chris was stabbed and leaving us with the melancholy line, "I never had any friends later on like the ones I did when I was 12. Jesus, does anyone?" before walking out to his family, figuratively closing the door on that chapter of his life and moving on.
Chris did get out. He enrolled in the college courses with me, and although it was hard, he gutted it out like he always did. He went on to college and eventually became a lawyer. Last week, he entered a fast food restaurant. Just ahead of him, two men got into an argument. One of them pulled a knife. Chris, who had always made the best peace, tried to break it up. He was stabbed in the throat. He died almost instantly.
Can we go now?
You ready?
Yeah, we've been ready for an hour.
Okay, I'll be right there.
You said that a half hour ago.
Yeah, my dad's weird. He gets like that when he's writing.
Thank you.